Good morning and welcome at iTechs TV. We are here in Rabat at Sofitel, Jardin des Roses. And we are pleased to receive Mr. Guy Philippe Goldstein, lecturer and researcher at School of Economic Warfare, and also senior advisor at PwC France. So we are glad to receive you. Welcome here.
Glad to be here too. Thank you. Thanks for the invitation.
So you were talking this morning about cybersecurity. So when we talk about cybersecurity, it's like it sounds a little bit strange for all the people that are here in Morocco, but also companies. So can you explain exactly what is the meaning of cybersecurity? What does cybersecurity represent?
Well, to put it in a nutshell today, cybersecurity is about protecting, evidently, your data, protecting your systems, but actually even more than that, protecting the trust that your clients and your shareholders may have invested in your company. Because if you actually fell prey to a cyber event, then you may lose the trust of your clients. If you lose the trust of your clients, you will lose the trust of your shareholders. You will even also lose the trust of your employees. And then, and there are cases where actually the valuation of companies can actually go down quite a large number. In the US, there was one example back 10 years ago of a payment processor company that fell prey to cyber attack and lost about 50% of shareholders' value. And actually, it's a small study I've run with PwC. We've shown that in about 63% of public incidents of company, publicly listed companies that fell prey to this type of attacks, they lost about 9 to 10% of shareholders' value after 1 month. So quite a sizable event, because at stake, it's actually the reputation of a company. But what that show actually, you know, on the other side of that is that if you're good at cyber, then you can tell to your customer, hey, we have reached that level of quality. And the whole gameplay then becomes, you know, I have reached not the Swiss made type of quality that used to be in the old industry, but another type of quality, because I can be cyber resilient, my system are good, my company is good. And that, you know, comes to play into what we call cyber power today. If you have a critical mass of companies which are very good in cybersecurity, then in a way, you will become, or you'll start to become a cyber power, a nation that can be economically influential because your company look sound and they actually can provide lots of services, including, of course, cybersecurity services. Mm-hmm. And all that, of course, is going to build your influence.
Alors, we know that and when you see the media and everything, the actuality, every 2 months there is a huge, problem, catastrophe with companies, with the cybersecurity, data and everything. So these things seem to be always changing. How do you prepare a company to be always update with this kind of technology?
This is a very good question. Actually, now I want to elevate the question in terms of, say, how you build a cyber power. This is a question that a couple of countries have asked themselves. For example, Israel, back 10 years ago. And they were thinking, okay, are we going to, say, pick a target or pick a bet on some certain technologies? Or are we going to select big companies that we're going to make into national champions? But they thought, just what you said, that actually things are always changing. So there's no point in picking up a technology per se or one company per se. What is very important is to have an ecosystem of talented people, because that will give you the maximum resilience. If you have all the talented guys, whatever the challenges ahead, they will be able to overcome that. And that's the whole game, I mean, both for a company, you know, focus on the talent, but also I would say in a more national level, develop cyber power. The whole game has been how I'm going to develop talent, the best talented people. And there are a couple of elements toward a recipe that can help you become a cyber power for the 21st century.
Just to have an idea, what is the cost of the cybersecurity? The incidence of a problem like this.
So I've run a study with PwC on that, preliminary study actually, but that showed that out of 30 incidents of publicly listed companies from 2008 to 2017, that had to announce that they had this cyber incident. There were about 63% of them that ended up with a stock price reduced to nearly 10% after 1 month. And for 40% of them, if they didn't rebound the right way, if they didn't manage the issue the right way, they would end up at minus 20% after 1 year. So quite a sizable event if you don't do things correctly.
Do you think that actually the country, especially, let's talk about Africa, that each government should have his own cybersecurity, which could be something global? I mean, something that you can like duplicate and have the same model everywhere. What do you think?
I think that it's definitely an element of national power. Mm-hmm. So on one end, every nation, every country, you know, as it depends on the power of the state, should actually invest in the development of national cybersecurity. That's one end. But then there's an interesting thing in terms of how are you good at that game? Because actually, at the end of the day, if you want to understand what happens, it's really an information game. You need to understand who did it, how it did, perhaps why. And for that, you cannot stay on your own corner. You need to exchange. You need to exchange with other countries. You need to exchange also with private companies or sometimes even universities. You need to be part of what I would call a white net of people exchanging information. And in a way, we're going back to a system of collective defense, as we've known, for example, in Europe with NATO since the end of the start of the Cold War, actually. The necessity to be part of that exchange market of information on cyber attacks actually forces people to cooperate together. So, sorry to say, but you have on one end to develop your own national cyber strategy because that's part of your sovereignty. But you also need to be part of that white net to exchange, to cooperate, to open up yourself. And that's actually one of the important elements of how you become a cyber power. To be very open to the right friends, and if I may, there are political implications here in the sense that if I look at, for example, the cyber defense market, it's mostly a market developed in the Western world with the environment of Western Europe, the US, liberal democracies, countries in Asia. But countries in Asia that would sustain also our Western liberal democratic way of thinking about rule of law, democracy, one vote, and so forth. And privacy also. And that's also important. We see countries that may have some difficulties to get into that market because they don't have exactly the same values. And we see companies that, unfortunately, because of the countries they belong to, sometimes difficult. I mean, look at, for example, a company like Kaspersky, very smart guys, but Russia today has some of the bad press with regards to democracy and so forth. And that has impact actually on the political, on the commercial development of Kaspersky.
Alors, my last question, Guy-Philippe Goldstein, this is about the ethics, about the reglementation. So you see that the part of people are starting to be aware about those technology, and when you talk about cybersecurity, they are afraid that companies collect data on everything. How do you think in the future we can manage to securize the data of the people on doing maybe bad things with this?
So it's a complex technical question because we even have studies that show all today that pseudonymization, for example, which is one way to go around that issue of privacy, doesn't actually pretty much work. Very few data points helps you to identify, authenticate precisely who is what. But that being said, a starting base is, for example, what was enshrined in the GDPR regulation in Europe. That is, you always need to ask the consent of the user. You need to, and it needs to be an informed consent. That's a tricky one, but to try to explain why you're going to use the data. You need to minimize the amount of data that can be used. That's also something that we heard about Estonia, that you, whenever you need data for certain application, you need to take all the data of anyone, just the level, the minimum amount of data that is needed, say, to allow you to access this or that thing. So minimization of data is important, informed consent, and of course, to have all the proper application in terms of cybersecurity. But at the end of the day, you always need to think about the user. You can't say, hey, I'm going to get the data of user and then whatnot, I don't care. At the end of the day, the world is transparent. The users will know if a company did the wrong things. And it's very important, as you ask data to users, that you give back something to the users. Mm. That's also an important dimension.
Thank you, Mr. Guy-Philippe Goldstein, lecturer and researcher at Schools of Economic Warfare and also senior advisor at PwC France. Hope that you enjoy your time at the ITEX, and thank you very much for sharing your expertise here in Morocco and also for the African continent. So thank you. So welcome at the website. Follow us, hashtag ITEX 2019, and also at the website, AfricaITExpo.mr. Thank you.
And thanks for the invitation.